Good morning. Excuse me, and welcome to St. Paul's. Welcome to our newcomers. We invite you to join us in the fellowship space following the service. Today, we welcome St. Paul's own Father Henry Doyle to celebrate and share a message with us. Next Sunday, the 28th, our fun, loving, talented choir is hosting a sing-along. The choir will provide finger food, and this is a time of fellowship, enjoying singing, and just being together in room 2, which is next to the nursery on that side of the building. No prerequisites, just join in the sing-along, make a joyful noise. Everyone is welcome. The Epistle, our weekly digital church communication, is on a break the next 2 weeks in July because Lori is on vacation, much needed. The flowers today were given by Sarah Jameson in honor of her daughter Emma's marriage to Jake, and they were arranged by Nancy McDuffie. Welcome.
Good morning. At this time, I'd like for us to recognize two young people, TJ and Bree, if they would please come forward. TJ and Bree yesterday had a lemonade stand there at Habitat for Humanity, and they made lots of cookies, which they're sharing with us today, and which they also, so there's some cookies there, and if you would like to donate, please do so. But again, TJ and Bree, thank you for helping out with this ministry, because they need a refreshment. Thank you. We'll begin our opening liturgy with All Things Bright and Beautiful.
Thank you.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we perfectly love you, worthy magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, the fountain of all wisdom, you know our necessities before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Have compassion on our weakness and mercifully give us those things for which our unworthiness we dare not and for our blindness we cannot ask. Through the worthiness of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. A reading from the prophet Jeremiah. Woe to the shepherds who destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, says the Lord. Therefore, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who shepherd my people, it is you who have scattered my flock and have driven them away, and you have not attended to them. So I will attend to you for your evil doings, says the Lord. Then I myself will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the lands where I have driven them, and I will bring them back to their fold, and they shall be fruitful and multiply. I will raise up shepherds over them who will shepherd them, and they shall not fear any longer or be dismayed, nor shall any be missing, says the Lord. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely, and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days, Judah shall be saved, and Israel will live safely. And this is the name by which he will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
We will read Psalm 23 responsively by half verse. The Lord is my shepherd. He makes me lie down in green pastures.
And leads me beside
the waters. He revives my soul.
And guides me along my pathways to his name.
Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me. Surely your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
The second reading is from Ephesians. Remember that at one time you Gentiles by birth, called the uncircumcised, by those who are called the circumcision, a physical circumcision made in the flesh by human hands. Remember that you were at that time without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace. In his flesh he has made both groups into one and has broken down the dividing wall, that is, the hostility between us. He has abolished the law with its commandments and ordinances, that he might create in himself one new humanity in place of two, thus making peace, and might reconcile both groups to God in one body through the cross, thus putting to death that hostility through it. So he came and proclaimed peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near, for through him both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. The apostles gathered around Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught. He said to them, "Come away to a deserted place all by yourselves and rest a while." For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. And they went away in the boat to a deserted place by themselves. Now many saw them going and recognized them, and they hurried there on foot from all the towns and arrived ahead of them. As he went ashore, Jesus saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them because they were like sheep without a shepherd, and he began to teach them many things. When they had crossed over, they came to land at Gennesaret and moored the boat. And when they got out of the boat, people at once recognized him and rushed about that whole region and began to bring the sick on mats to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he went, into villages or cities or farms, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and begged him that they might touch even the fringe of his cloak, and all who touched it were healed. The Gospel of the Lord. With St. Paul's Episcopal Church. I enrolled in graduate school in 1979, and I lived on the campus of CSU. I did not have a car and was very happy when I knew that there was an Episcopal church right across the street. And moreover, it thrilled me even more that there was a 7:30 service, because I liked the early service. I liked to go to church early and get it done with. I hate to say it that way, but it was done. All right. So I went to the 7:30 service. I didn't sit in the back. I kind of sat in the middle. Apparently, I didn't take anybody's pew, which was a good thing. Now listen, it was right one. I was not a fan of the exchange of peace. But it astonished me when Tommy and Marty Bertolette ran over to shake my hand and to greet me, to welcome me to St. Paul's. They were the only children there. In the front pew sat the Reynolds family with their three. And the Thomas family had also made it to church, and they sat in the back. And it took them long to get to church than probably anyone else, because they lived out by where Hewlett-Packard is. Also, during the announcements, they mentioned about coffee hour. Coffee hour? I'm not going to that. I don't drink coffee, and who would have a coffee hour? I want to go to church and get home, get back to campus. But of course, people welcomed, said, come to coffee hour. And I said, I got to get back to campus. So I must admit, for a good year or so, I avoided coffee hour. But eventually I did. Well, if you want to know more about my association with St. Paul's, I can tell you about it later. But I certainly have cherished and loved being a part of this parish, even though you only see me once a year. And even though I only contribute to the parish funds twice a year at Christmas and Easter. But each of you does matter to me, and I again say it is a joy and a privilege to serve today as a celebrant and preacher at St. Paul's. Let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be accepted in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. July 4th this year, my plans changed. What I was planning to do was not going to happen. You know, I'm trying to be a go-go senior as long as I can. You see, there are three classifications for those of us who are seniors: the go-go, the slow-go, and the no-go. And I'm trying to remain the go-go. My life is always going, going, going. And I decided on July 4th that it was going to be a quiet day. I was up early at my usual time. I did morning prayer. But I decided not to turn on the radio, not to listen to the news that morning. In fact, I didn't turn on the radio until about 8 o'clock that night. I needed a break from it. I started to go outside, but then it began to rain, so I got back in. I was thrilled it was a no-drive day. It was just good to have some quiet time. It was good not to just to be always, always going, 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 going. So Jesus is reminding us today, unfortunately, Jesus couldn't get away from them, but we do need time away at times. We need to take a break, even from the news, even a break from our normal routines, and even a break sometimes from all of the, please don't get me wrong, a lot of the meditations that I receive. You see, I have four a day by day. I've got another booklet I read. And then I have about three or four that come on the computer. And then one that I've just got into recently, really like especially, is morning prayer from Washington Cathedral. It's a different form of morning prayer, so don't think it follows exactly the way it is. It's very different. And the messages are very, very good. I can't say I have a favorite, but I kind of do. But yeah, there's a time I know I need a break from it. We do. We need a time to center ourselves, to reflect, to disperse with all the noises out there. It's not that we don't care, but we need to take care of ourselves at times. And we need to see and think about what truly is important, what we do really need to focus on. In the gospel today, Jesus sees the people as being sheep without a shepherd. I like to think of us as not being sheep without a shepherd, but sheep with a shepherd. Because I know for myself, the psalm that we had this morning, I learned very early as a child. You see, before we had breakfast on Sunday morning, we recited Psalm 23, the King James Version, which I know still by heart, and which is a part of my daily prayer life. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Jesus is our shepherd, one who leads us, one who guides us, one who motivates us, one who looks after us, one who is with us at all times. You see, we can never, ever hide from God. Adam learned that very early on, that we cannot hide. We're always, always in the presence of God, and yet we're not always perfect, because I'm far from it. But what is wonderful is that we have a God who does forgive and says, move on, even though at times I find it hard to move on and will continue to be upset with myself because I was rude to the clerk in the store. Because I cut off that person when I was driving. Recently, a little road rage almost got into me. You see, I was driving home from Albert Lea, where I have, after celebrating Mass down there, and we were coming up to the chance that we're going to have to merge. And I didn't want to get behind the truck that was pulling the trailer. So I began to speed up. And I said, "Henry, stop it." I let him get ahead of me. "Go ahead, get in, merge." I wasn't on his tail while I was driving. I gave him some room. We got to where we were going. And so I wasn't all stressed up, you know, just tensed up like that. Because driving can do that to you sometimes. That's why I've been avoiding I-25 sometimes here. It's okay to take 287. Yeah, there are lights, but it's all right. Because we live in this world, not just with you who are gathered here, but people of all kinds, all races, all beliefs. I had to settle myself down just before I came to church this morning. Why? A friend, we've been friends for 55 years. He was 2 years ahead of me in college. I don't know where he is. I don't know what happened, but he and I differ greatly on a number of things. But we're friends. We're still friends. And this morning, he wrote something in his email. He says, "I hope that law in Louisiana that they posted on the Ten Commandments will not be abolished." And I'm sorry, I had to respond to him right away. Maybe I should have thought about it. You might disagree with me on my stance. But I told him, read the Constitution. I am a Christian. But the founding fathers, founding mothers, did not put in the Constitution for us to post the Ten Commandments in the public schools. It's going to be that button about it. Because if I believe the Ten Commandments we are, which version are we going to put in? There isn't just one version. Moreover, the public schools have students who are not only Christian, but Jewish, Buddhist, Muslim, Hindu, no religion. Am I to discount them? Should I not have their commandments posted as well? Okay. Enough said on that. I believe we ought to be and need to be very considerate of others. That's why in many ways sometimes I say, "Henry, put yourself in their shoes." You're not, but think about that. Before you go off spouting your mouth and saying what you're for or against. One of my former students was hesitant yesterday, but she says, "Father," she sent me a message, "I know you're busy, but, and I know you may not want to do this because you don't approve, but Shelby and I are going to get married next year on June 14th. Will you do our wedding?" "Thank you, Emily, for the invitation. It will be a joyful honor to join you and Shelby in marriage." She wrote back, it'll be in Illinois. I said, that's fine. I do weddings all over.
What?
I've known Emily since she was just a month old. And she's turning 25. Some may not approve that these two women are going to join in marriage.
Please, honey, you better, you're not having enough hope.
It's not up to me to approve or disapprove. It's up to me to express God's love for her and express my love for her and for Shelby.
You can help.
And to fill the role, the officiant, at their wedding. God created all of us. And God loves every one of us, despite who we are. And you and I are challenged every day to express the love of God by what we say and by what we do. Not only this morning, but tomorrow morning, Wednesday evening, Saturday night, wherever. We are the community of faith. We are God's people. And God is our shepherd.
There are your napkins, whatever hanging up on there. Yeah.
Thank you.
Right there. Did you help?
If you're able, let us stand and say the creed, please. We believe in God above us, maker and sustainer of all life, of sun and moon, of water and earth, of male and female. We believe God beside us, Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh, born of a woman, servant of the poor, tortured and nailed to a tree. A man of sorrows, he died forsaken. He descended into the earth to the place of death. On the third day, he rose from the tomb. He ascended into heaven to be everywhere present, and his kingdom will come on earth. We believe in God within us, the Holy Spirit of Pentecostal fire, life-giving breath of the church, spirit of healing and forgiveness, source of resurrection and of eternal life. Amen.
The prayers of the people. If you're joining us from home, please add your prayers to the chat box, and maybe I'll read them if I get the chat box. During the prayers, you're invited to go to one of the stands where lit candles are embedded in bowls of sand. You can offer a special prayer by choosing a candle from the pile next to the bowl, lighting it from the lit candle, and fixing it in the sand as you pray your prayer. Healing God, cure our ills and bless us. Help us to care for our neighbors whom you send to us. God, in your mercy, help us always speak truth in love. Help our leaders to do your will, caring for those in their charge. Give us the knowledge and wisdom to heal our planet. God, in your mercy, we pray for the church. We pray especially for our siblings in the 301 Faith Partnership, for Grace Episcopal Church in Georgetown, St. Ambrose Episcopal Church in Boulder, St. James Episcopal Church in Lake City, the Episcopal Church of St. Peter and Mary in Denver, and our Diocesan Jubilee Ministries. We pray also for the Nippon Seiko Kei. God, in your mercy, grant that we may offer the help they truly need to all those whom we accompany through life's difficulties. We pray for the unhoused, for the food insecure, for migrants and immigrants, and for the people of Haiti. Loving God, shepherd those who have died into the green pastures of your presence. Guide us as well into goodness and mercy, now and at the hour of our death. God, in your mercy, let us pray for our own needs and those of others. For healing, we pray for Carol, John, Patsy, and Buddy, Kelly, Stan, Kim, Tara, Fred, Cindy, and Jim. We pray prayers of thanksgiving for grandchildren and butterflies, and for special intentions for Nick and Marty. Most merciful God, accept and fulfill our petitions, we pray, not as we ask in our ignorance and in our limited understanding, but out of your knowledge of and boundless love for us, through your Son, Jesus the Christ.
Happy are those whose sins are forgiven, whose wrongs are pardoned. I will confess my sins to the Lord. I will not conceal my wrongdoings. We need your healing, merciful God. Give us true repentance. Some sins are plain to us. Some escape us. Some we cannot face. Forgive us. Set us free to hear your word to us. Set us free to serve you. To the cross of Christ, God have mercy on you. Pardon you and set you free. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. God strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in eternal life. Amen. And the peace of the Lord be always with you. Prayers for travel, anything today?
Traveling.
Traveling, all right, great, all right. Let's pray. Oh, she's coming. All right, good, good, good. Gracious God, we ask you to be with your beloved servants as they travel. Watch over them, Lord our God, with all the angels and saints, protect them. Help them to reach their destination safely and to have a refreshing and joyful time away from home. And bring them back safely to us. All this we ask in your most holy name. Amen.
Amen. Peace be with you.
Peace be with you. Thank you. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself as an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
This morning, the Holy Eucharist offers to the glory of God, and in thanksgiving for the life, death, resurrection, ascension of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. With special intention on this day, in thanksgiving for the rector of this parish, we give thanks for her ministry and ask you, Lord our God, by your Holy Spirit, to guide, strengthen, and encourage and motivate her in her ministry to this parish and to others beyond this parish. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We thank you, Creator God, that we live in a place where the glorious revelation of yourself is all around us. The prairie bursts with song from wind and birds and waving grasses. The abundance of animals roaming freely reminds us of our own freedom and the many ways you provide sustenance in your kingdom. From the depths of the ocean floor, you lifted your massive mountains and pointed them toward the heavens. We, like your Son, are called to these high places to get away and rest in communion with you. We marvel as we wander through stately pines and twirling aspens along the creeks, where trout dance on their tails above the rocks, and deer and elk sip from the water's edge. And remember that you have given us the living water to quench our thirst. Our spirit is refreshed and our strength renewed. We welcome the passing of seasons in broad circles of time with anticipation of new things to come. And we recognize that same feeling of hope that encircles our faith. Our lives are being lived between sunrises and sunsets and brilliant colors. But at night, the limitless stars have a way of pushing back the boundaries of our lives, and we dream of heaven and your wonder. And with all these blessings of your creation all around us, O God, we come together in communities on the prairie, by rivers and streams, on mountaintops and in their shadows in the valley, to receive your word, which has been sown in rich soil and grown into a fruitful crop in the body of Christ. And so we join the saints and angels and proclaim your glory as we sing. As we gather to praise your name, we see your greatest glory, your Son, our Savior, reflected in each other's faces, and we know the magnitude of your love for us and ours for you. On the night before he died for us, Jesus was at table with his friends. He took bread, gave thanks to you, broke it, gave it to them, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." As supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. Again he gave thanks to you and gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood, new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Now gathered at your table, O God of all creation, remembering Christ who lived and died as one of us, crucified and risen, who was and is to come, we offer you our gifts of bread and wine and ourselves, a living sacrifice. Pour out your spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the body and blood of Christ. Breathe your spirit over the whole earth and make us your new creation, the body of Christ given for the world you have made. In the fullness of time, bring us with all your saints from every tribe and language and people and nation to feast at the banquet prepared from the foundation of the world. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. The gifts of God for the people of God, the body and blood of Christ, behold you are, become what you receive. Let us pray. Loving God, we give you thanks for restoring us in your image and nourishing us with the spiritual food in the sacrament of Christ's body and blood. Now send us forth a people forgiven, healed, renewed, that we proclaim your love to the world and continue in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. Almighty God, I give you thanks for the privilege of celebrating the Holy Eucharist at the altar of St. Paul's Episcopal Church in Fort Collins, Colorado. I thank you for all your people who have gathered here this day and for having fed us with your word and sacrament. We also remember today, Lord our God, those who are absent from us because of work, travel, for whatever reason. Help us, Lord our God, to continue to believe and trust in your goodness and love for us, and send us forth as your proclaimers of the gospel by what we say and by what we do. All this we ask in your most holy name. Amen. May God bless you with enough foolishness to believe that you really can. Never mind, I'll go to my sheet. May God bless you with a restless discomfort about easy answers, half-truths, and spiritual relationships, so that you may seek truth boldly and love deep within your heart. May God bless you with holy anger at injustice, oppression, and exploitation of people, so that you may tirelessly work for justice, freedom, and peace among all people. May God gift you with the gift of tears to shed for those who suffer from pain, rejection, starvation, or the loss of all that they cherish, so that you may reach out your hand to comfort them and transform their pain into joy. May God bless you with enough foolishness to believe that you really can make a difference in this world, so that you're able with God's grace to do what others claim they cannot be done. And may God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit bless and keep you always. Amen. The church is one foundation.
Thank you. peace to love and serve the Lord and one another. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.